Today on a very special episode of Wild Florida, we dedicate our entire program to a remarkable Florida animal sanctuary called the Center for Great Apes. Here, life is good for the resident chimpanzees and orangutans, but it hasn't always been so. Most were torn from their parents. Many spent years living in substandard conditions, and all were denied the life apes were truly meant to have. Where did they come from? How did they get here? We'll find out. I'm Hunter Reno, and this is Wild Florida.
It's early morning here in Wachula in South Central Florida. In a short while, the enclosures behind me will be filled with the chatter of chimpanzees and orangutans. So why are these apes here? Well, like many Floridians, they came here to retire.
Today I'm meeting with Beth Schaefer. She's one of 9 animal handlers who work here full-time at the Center for Great Apes. The center rescues and rehabilitates chimpanzees and orangutans that are no longer wanted by pet owners or that have outlived their usefulness for the entertainment industry.
So Beth, how big is the property and how many apes do you have on here now?
We have 100 acres, about 40 of it is developed right now, and we have 38 apes here.
38.
Yes.
Now, I haven't heard or seen any.
Yes, it's a little early and it's a little chilly this morning, so they're all still in their little nests, all bundled up asleep, and they'll be waking up pretty soon here. So this is one of our night houses back here.
So we're gonna go and wake everybody up?
Yeah. You can see how everybody's doing. I should warn you, they can be very loud with people they haven't met before. Okay. So just a little heads up that it might be a little ear splitting.
Okay.
So I'll introduce you to everybody. We have Jerry over here and her
Hi,
son,
Jerry.
Jam.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, Jerry.
Nice to meet you.
What a big girl.
You're so sweet. Oh,
and
this is little Jam, our little 4-year-old.
Hello, Jam. You look precocious.
He's very precocious. Aren't you, baby? Here goes Sammy with his display back here.
What sound is he making? Is that a particular call?
Yeah, that's called a long call that he's winding up for. It's not a full long call because I think he's just inside. But the males make that as a territorial noise. Yeah.
It sounds like the motor of an engine.
Doesn't it? Yeah.
So what do we need to do to let him out?
Well, first we need to get their breakfast all put out in their enclosure and get it all set up, and then we can let him out.
Can I help you?
Yep.
So what are they working on over there, Beth?
Oh, that's our new orangutan outdoor enclosure that we're going to have. Looks like the crews are just getting going here this morning. So it's a little loud during the day, but it'll be nice when
structure.
It's finished. Yeah, it's huge. It'll be nice.
It will also be expensive. By the time it's outfitted with swings and climbing gear, this 35-foot tall enclosure will have cost $225,000 to build. That's a huge expense. Then again, as Patty Reagan, the founder of the Center for Great Apes, explained to me earlier, nothing comes cheaply when it comes to great apes.
Second only to whales and elephants, great apes require the strongest and the most expensive habitats and the most care. The care cost is between $10,000 and $11,000 a year for each ape. And when you have a 3-year-old here that will live 50 years, that will, you know, inflate. And so we have probably $1 million commitment for each of the young, really young apes that are here.
Luckily, the drop's not too far.
Since the center receives no state or government funding, all of that money comes from private donations and grants, which aren't easy to come by.
See what we got? We've got a combination of bananas, apples, biscuits, taste treats.
I'm going to put some t-shirts out for them because they love to put on t-shirts.
You're kidding. They really like putting on clothes.
Yeah, they think it's fun. Jerry especially likes to do little changes during the day. She'll wear one shirt, then she'll change into another shirt.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's great.
Because apes are such intelligent creatures, it's important that they stay active and stimulated. So each enclosure has what animal handlers call enrichment. That can be toys to play with, clothes to wear, structures to climb, food to hunt for, barrels to swing on, anything that requires some thought and keeps the apes active and interested in their surroundings.
Hunter, that's for the apes.
I think I weigh about as much as one of the females. It's quite appropriate. Are we ready?
I think it looks good.
Once the enclosure is locked, we're ready to unleash the orangutans. Well, technically, they never run free. They'll move from the night house to the enclosure through this chute.
Okay, out you go.
Have a good day.
Go on, go ahead.
How you guys doing?
So they got all their food. Did you go straight for the food?
Typical orangutans, very food motivated.
Now you said orangutan, and I, all my life, I think I've said hello. I've said orangutans.
Yeah, that's
it's not orangutans.
No, there's no G on the end. That's very common mispronunciation of the word. The word orangutan is actually two words from the Bahasa language of Indonesia. Leave it, Jam. You can leave that.
You want me to hang out with you?
As Beth struggles to release me from Jam's grip, this seems a good time to mention just how strong these apes really are. I'm told that if you compared any of these orangutans to a person of equal weight, the orangutan would easily be 7 to 10 times as strong. That's why Beth and the other animal handlers never enter an enclosure while the apes are loose inside.
Good boy!
Thank you. So how did all these apes come here?
Most of the apes that are here are from the pet and entertainment industry. Mm-hmm. These three acted in commercials and movies and things like that.
In fact, many of the orangutans and chimps here at the center are ones you would probably recognize from television or movies.
Yet those were all pulled from their mothers. They're made to work on set, on camera. Most of them have a short working life. They'll be out of the business by the time that they're 8 or 9. And where do they go? Mm-hmm. And that's the problem. They have 40 years ahead of them. If accredited zoos like Metro Zoo or San Diego Zoo or Zoo Atlanta won't take these animals.
Who takes them?
Who takes them?
Here you go, girl.
All right, George.
Ron McGill is the communication director at the Miami Metro Zoo. He knows better than most why apes raised by humans can't come here.
You couldn't take a pet chimpanzee and then reintroduce it to this wild group without significant consequences. You know, it's like taking an infant that was born and raised in a padded room and then putting it in the middle of Times Square and saying socialize it. It's an extremely stressful situation, and these pet primates never make good candidates for zoo collections.
There are actually 9 sanctuaries in North America that can handle chimpanzees, but most are already at or near capacity. And as for orangutans, the Center for Great Apes is actually the only nonprofit sanctuary that can accept them. Unfortunately, the rate at which Hollywood and the pet industry uses and disposes of apes outpaces the rate at which responsible sanctuaries can grow to accommodate them. That means that some unlucky apes will end up elsewhere, in a cramped cage, at a roadside zoo, or in a breeder's compound, where their babies will be taken from them to begin the cycle all over again.
So where are we off to now?
We're gonna go and meet Radcliffe.
He's a big boy.
Yeah, he's big now. So you can see, you know, those cute little babies that you see when they're in the movies are actually very young animals. Once they get too big to be worked, they grow up to be this.
So what was Radcliffe's situation before he came here?
So Radcliffe was actually an animal that grew up in the circus, and then when he got too big to work in the circus, was sold to several different roadside zoos. The most recent one, he lived in a 10 by 10 cement enclosure with chain link. So when he arrived, he was very emaciated. He was really skinny. His skin was gray. He had almost no hair on his body. And so with proper nutrition and just a little bit of attention and respect and things to do, his hair's all grown back, he's all glossy, and he's obviously a very happy orangutan. Yeah, he loves to play.
As luck would have it, I'm visiting on Radcliffe's 28th birthday, which gives Beth and me an excuse to break out a bottle of bubbles.
For some reason, they love to put their bubbles on their tongues.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Radcliffe. Happy birthday to you. More?
After our little birthday celebration with Radcliffe, Beth and I leave the orangutan area and head out to meet a few of the 27 chimpanzees that live on a different part of the compound. The two species don't mix in the wild, and they don't mix here. Did you know that there are actually four types of great apes? Great apes include chimpanzees, orangutans, gorillas, and the rarest of all apes, the bonobo. Also known as the pygmy chimp, the bonobo is actually our closest animal relative. Tragically, though, it's been hunted to near extinction in the African Congo.
Look at that. Oh, and look, there's a couple of our chimps. Two of our little girls, little Coda and Natsu, they're playing together in the chutes.
So Beth, I've seen the chutes all around the property, but tell me how they work for the apes.
The chutes are what connects all of our outdoor enclosures together. We can configure them differently through a series of doors, and it allows the apes to go around and see different parts of the property. We can walk them to our veterinary clinic through those chutes, so we don't have to put them under anesthesia to move them over there for exams and things. They can just walk over. So it gives us a lot of flexibility and them a lot of fun.
Oh, definitely. Well, let's go meet the other chimpanzees.
Okay. So our youngest little chimpanzee is over here with his mom, playing up in the chute at the
baby.
Moment.
Now, but that's not very normal for you, Beth, to have a baby here, is it?
It's not. As a sanctuary, we don't breed. He actually came with his mom. He was born just before she got here. So he's actually very lucky. He's the first ape at this sanctuary to ever be raised by his mom. Because typically, in entertainment, they're pulled from their moms right away to be raised by humans so they can use them in the movies and things.
What's his name?
This is Stryker.
Stryker.
Yeah.
Stryker's mom, Jessie, is also lucky. Stryker is her third baby, but the first she's been allowed to keep. With two girls of my own, I can't stand the thought of that kind of brutal separation. But that thought is quickly interrupted anyway.
Big males doing a display here.
Oh, yeah.
And actually, so if you look at little baby Stryker, who's so cute, who everyone would love to have as a pet in their house, this is what Stryker's going to grow up to be. So you can see why.
Pretty hard to believe, but I can see.
It is hard to believe that tiny little thing will grow up to be this big, as big as these two boys, and that powerful as well. He's going to throw some sand here.
Oh, he is?
And we typically just
try not to. Is that because he loves me?
That's a defensive thing on his part. He likes to display and say, this is my territory, this is my family, mine.
Okay.
So he'll do that. He'll throw things to just to let you know that he's the boss.
Okay, I'll give you your space.
I've seen some strange behaviors here. Some, I'm told, are natural. Others learned in circuses or on movie sets. But still others are a sign of neurosis. Take Marco, for instance.
He worked in the circuses for 20 years, and then he lived for 25 years in the retired trainer's garage. And in a 10 by 10 cage. He had no other chimpanzees the last 25 years of his life. He didn't have space, so now he's come here, he's in our quarantine cage, he's alone. Right now he has a crush on one of our interns. And that's not unlikely. All he knows is humans. He's been raised by humans, he identifies with humans. We'd like to give this guy an opportunity in his life to live with a female chimpanzee.
And we have the three girls up here, so we're going to want to kind of duck and go pretty quick because they usually try to grab. Hi, girls. It's okay, girls. So, yeah, they're kind of showing
off
there a little bit. Yeah. And over here we have one of our special little girls, Denise.
Denise, that's impressive. Hi, Denise.
What's she doing, sweetie pie?
Is she just mad or just letting us know?
She's just kind of letting us know what's going on. There's people, new people. She doesn't know in her area, so she's kind of wondering what's going on. But Denise came to us. She was actually a pet in a backyard for 35 years. She was eating a jar of marshmallow fluff, a can of cherry pie filling, and a beer every day as her diet. So we really had to transitioner to a healthy diet of the primate chow and vegetables and fruits that we feed here.
Did she put up with that?
We kind of had to go a little slow. We had to kind of go through a little detox with her. But she actually adjusted really, really well.
Since we are approaching lunchtime, Beth suggested I head over to the center's kitchen to see just how different the food here is. Amy Knighton is the woman who prepares it all.
Amy, this is a huge amount of food. Mm-hmm. What are we talking about a week?
About 500 pounds.
500 pounds, mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. Now, what are some of the more favorite items?
Everybody loves steamed onions.
Steamed onions, mm-hmm. Well, mm-hmm. Here's your steamed onion. How many per bowl?
This one gets 5 halves.
Okay, 5 halves. Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 5.
Yes.
Now, I saw this when I walked in. I'm intrigued.
Yeah, I just made that. That's monkey chow cake.
Monkey chow mm-hmm. cake.
We take the dust from their chow uh-huh. and mix it like 2 parts that, 2 parts flour. Add any kind of dried fruit, vanilla, things like that for seasoning.
I almost mm-hmm. want to eat some, but I'm going to hold on.
Really love it. They do.
Good boy. Good.
Hey, Beth.
Hey, Hunter.
I heard your whistle.
Oh, did you? We're just having a little training session with
Beth. Yeah.
What exactly does a training session accomplish?
Most of our training sessions involve what we call husbandry behaviors, which are behaviors that help us take better care of our apes, mm-hmm. like brushing their teeth. Can you open? Let's brush your teeth. Open. More. Good. Very nice. Good boy.
It's a chance to interact with them. Most of them think it's very fun, so it's enriching for them.
And the whistle, so how does it work? They show and you beep, or you beep and they show?
No, when they've done the behavior correctly, I blow the whistle. And when you're trying to shape a new behavior, you have to take little teeny tiny increments. So he just let me touch his tongue with the tongue depressor, then I'm going to whistle. Ultimately, I want him to stick his tongue all the way out before I whistle, but you have to go in little steps.
Can you open your mouth? Good, where's your tongue? This tongue, stick it out. This. No, 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 no. Oh, sometimes they're bad. Yeah. We knew you. I would give you that if you traded it back. Where's your tongue? Stick your tongue out.
Mm-mm. He reminds me of my daughter, Chloe.
Does she stick her tongue out a lot?
Yes.
A little more teeth.
Likes lots of treats.
Oh, yeah. Does she learn to manipulate you to get more treats?
She already has in a year and a half.
Like Radcliffe, many of the center's apes have really thrived here. But that's especially true for one little chimp.
That's Knuckles here. Oh. Hey, Lexi, do you mind if we take Knuckles for a walk?
Go ahead.
We can do his 3 o'clock banana for you.
And?
We can take Knuckles over here. Knuckles has cerebral palsy, so he needs Knuckles. Some extra special attention. He gets physical therapy. He gets special playtimes in a special enclosure that's made just for him. He really likes his banana, so we'll just get it started for him. And if you want to just hold that out for him, you can see if he'd like to eat it.
There you go.
He'll just take a bite by himself. Very good.
How does Knuckles relate with the other chimps that are here? Does he get to, or?
He does. He goes and visits the other chimps, and it really is quite amazing to see them together. They seem to know that Knuckles needs extra special care, and they'll just hug him and tickle him and play with him. And they're excited to see him, and he's always excited to see them.
When Knuckles first arrived here, he could barely walk. Now he gets around pretty well, most of the time.
Oh, he wants to swing.
You want to swing?
Let's see if you'll walk on your own. You're supposed to be walking. That's part of your exercise.
Even with his disability, Knuckles seems very human to me. I guess it shouldn't surprise me. Patty and Beth have both told me how each one of the apes here has a different personality, playful or serious, anxious or easygoing. And just like humans, their moods often change.
One boy who's an ex-circus boy, Chipper, his day, he just is distraught if I haven't come down first thing in the morning to spend time with him. And often, it's only a few minutes that I need to just let him groom me and talk to him and ask how he is this morning, and then he's fine. But if I haven't done that in the morning and I walk by with some visitors, he will have a tantrum, he will cry, and yet if I've gone to have that morning talk, he's just quiet.
After we leave Knuckles, Beth heads out to do a few of the 35 loads of laundry they do here a day, and she gives me the go-ahead to walk around unescorted. I feel really lucky to be here. Although the Center for Great Apes is open one day a year to donors, the center is actually closed to the public. It's a sanctuary, after all. And Patty says that most of these animals have been on display so long that they really deserve a break. Unfortunately, none of these apes living at the center will ever be returned to the wild. Because they've been raised by humans, they simply don't have the necessary survival skills. But even if they could survive outside, they'd likely have nowhere to go. Why? Because what little wild habitat orangutans and chimpanzees have left in the world is quickly disappearing. For orangutans, that habitat is two islands in Southeast Asia, Sumatra and Borneo. For chimpanzees, that territory is a swath across the middle of Africa. In both places, illegal hunting or poaching and deforestation have decimated the ape populations. Now, experts estimate that there are fewer than 125,000 chimpanzees left in the world, down from 1 to 2 million a century ago, and fewer, perhaps drastically fewer, than 25,000 orangutans. Those diminishing numbers make these guys all the more special. How could you not want to save them? They're so similar to us, from the tender way they raise their young to the way they react when they're taken from them. Apes suffer much like humans do. They become depressed, they experience loneliness, they feel afraid. Of course, as Ron McGill explained to me, they may express themselves differently.
Ironically, their facial expressions aren't really the same as they are with us. You know, for instance, if a primate shows his teeth and is smiling or opens his eyes really wide, it's not necessarily a sign of glee or a sign of happiness or content. It can be a sign of stress and anger.
Think about that next time you see an ape monkeying around in a commercial. By 5 o'clock, it's time to put the apes to bed.
Doesn't sound like they're really ready for bed yet, but we're back at the night house and we're just gonna tuck everybody in.
Hey, Beth.
Hey, Sammy's just giving us a little display here.
Incredible, what can I help you with?
I'm just gonna get everybody's bedrooms ready, so if you maybe wanna spread some blankets in these two bedrooms and then we'll get their biscuits ready for them.
Just on the floor or up on the platforms?
Both if you'd like, wherever you want.
In the wild, orangutans will build nests from branches. Here, they'll make a nest from these blankets, and they'll sleep soundly in them for 12 hours.
What do you think, Sammy? I think this one's quite appropriate.
Except it's chimps.
Except it's chimps, Beth says. Ta-da.
Once the blankets are spread out and the door is locked, it's time to call the other orangutans home for supper. Dinner is a sweet potato and fresh strawberries, tasty enough that one greedy ape wants more than his fair share.
You got some in there. You got one in there.
Good night, guys.
Good night. See you in the morning.
With Sammy, Tango, Jerry, and Jam tucked safely in their night house, Beth and I head out. She'll begin preparing now for the following day, but I'm eager to get home to see my daughters. It's been a remarkable and eye-opening day for me. Knowing the price these apes have paid to serve as our companions and to entertain us, I can't imagine that I'll ever look at another ape in a movie or commercial in the same way. Still, I recognize how few people will get to experience this place, so I'm afraid it will be a long path to the day when apes will truly be left to be apes.
This program continues on the Wild Florida website at wildflorida.tv. Wild Florida is available on DVD for $19.95 plus $3.95 for shipping and handling. To order your copy, please call 1-800-533-8321.
Stop for a little refreshment.
We'll break there.
You ready? They're like, enough with that. Give us the strawberries already.
Yeah, let's go. Come on, come on, come on.
Yeah.
May Major funding for Wild Florida is provided by the Bachelor Foundation, encouraging you to enjoy and preserve the natural beauty of Florida. Additional funding provided by the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, managing Florida's fish and wildlife resources for their long-term well-being. Florida Department of Environmental Protection, Division of Recreation and Parks, offering fun in the real Florida, Florida's state parks. Florida Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services, Division of Forestry, managing Florida's forest resources through a stewardship ethic that assures their use for future generations. Visit Florida, the state's official source for travel planning, at visitflorida.com.